the money that they spent. Take another look and take some time for hemp. Don't cut trees for paper, cause it hurts the environment. Stop deforestation, yeah, it's time for hemp. An acre of hemp makes 20 barrels of oil. No need for pesticides to poison all our soil. People got no food, they got no clothes, they got no rent. Well, it's time for hemp. Yeah.
Thank you for taking time for hemp. I'm your host, Casper Leitch, and you are listening to the live broadcast of Time for Hemp all around the world on AmericanFreedomRadio.com and on AM/FM stations all across America. If you get chance, please go to time4hemp.com and check out the website. You'll find that there's lots of free MP3s to download. You can order a really cool t-shirt if you like. And if you've got one of those groovy high-end cell phones, you can access every single file on the website on your handheld cell phones. Use your transmitters in those cell phones and in your iPods to broadcast the information through the car stereos and your home stereos, and share the information that is being put together in those shows with your friends and family. I also want to encourage you to go to AmericanFreedomRadio.com and click on the donate button. They are pulling up their tent stakes, and they're going to pitch a tent in another state. And if you want to help make that happen, just go to AmericanFreedomRadio.com and hit the donate button. I also want to say thank you to KDK Distributors. They are an amazing group of people working hard up in Canada to make certain that the shelves in those specialty stores that you shop in are filled with quality products. And KDK Distributors gives away a free vaporizer through Treating Yourself Magazine to anybody out there who has a medical need for marijuana but cannot afford a good quality vaporizer to ingest their medication. So if you want to find out more about that, you can go to Treating Yourself Magazine and check out the information that's found there. And if you can't find any information, contact us here at Time for Hemp. Send a letter to Casper at timeforhemp.com, and we will direct you to the right people to make that happen. On the program tonight, we are going to be talking about what's going on in California. I mean, everybody's talking about what's going on in California. And I can't think of anybody more prolific and more astute as to what's going on in California than Ed Rosenthal, who lives out there in the Oakland area. He'll be on in the last half of the show. He'll be joining Lynnett Shaw and I. Lynnett wrote the theme song, The Time for Hemp, but she did more than that. She also co-wrote Prop 215, and she has the very first medical marijuana dispensary in the state of California, and she helped invent the medical marijuana card that patients use to show to medical marijuana dispensaries in that state to get their medication. So she's been a true pioneer and one of the founding fathers, or in this case, a founding mother of the marijuana movement. I want to say thank you to all my friends and who have been busy putting Time for Hemp in their top 40 at MySpace. Because of that, your friends are finding our show. And when your friends find our broadcast, they find our guests, and it really is the guests that make this show so fantastic. With that said, pack a great big bowl of some Ed Rosenthal Kush. Make sure your friends are tuning in, and hurry up, come back after this commercial break, and take Time for Hemp.
listening to the Time for Hemp Global Broadcasting Network. The only broadcasting network dedicated to ending the global war on drugs on iHeartRadio.
Normal.org and find out if there's a chapter in your neck of the woods, and if there is, join it. If there's not, get together with a couple of friends and maybe become part of the solution. Don't just sit there and eat Twinkies and watch Desperate Housewives and be part of the problem. On the program tonight, I think my joint host is with me. Lynnett, are you there?
Casper.
Hi, Lynnett. Right, let me rephrase that. Are you high, Lynnett?
When am I not?
Oh, actually, okay.
Medical users don't really get high. We just have a better, you know, better life, and our conditions get ameliorated. You know.
Yeah, I do know, because ever since I started using marijuana for medicinal purposes, I quit sitting down and smoking out to the point where I could just like stare at a candle for an hour and listen to Billy Paul. You know, now I just get like the little edge off and quit being such a pain in the neck to the people around me, and I put the pipe down and get busy.
There you go.
Yeah. So, I don't know, Lynnett, there are some people out there who are talking about this little thing called Proposition 19. I don't know if you've ever heard about it. You're out in California. Let me tell you about it. They're trying to pass a tax so that you can smoke it for recreational purposes. It's just really cutting edge. You ought to check it out. Have you heard about it?
I'm deep in it there. And you, as you well know, I've co-founded the Marijuana Peace Coalition in Hollywood, covering the entertainment industry in the greater LA there, because we have a lot of support, but people haven't really heard a lot about it, you know, and we're a grassroots campaign. Our wonderful friend Richard Lee spent all his money getting on the ballot to give us all a chance to stop the war against the people and you know, start looking at this marijuana thing with adult, you know, adult eyes here. We don't need to have a nanny state anymore, you know.
No, it's funny you should say, you know, I lived out in Hollywood for a while. When I did, I used to dance under the name Grassroots.
Of course. And it is not, it's not so weird there. It's Hollywood has a lot of really talented people who are all working together and working a lot. The internet has revolutionized the music and the movie industry, the entertainment industry, has leveled the playing field in many ways. It has allowed the discovery or rediscovery of many artists and who are welcomed back to the industry. The old studio system has gone down the way that dinosaurs went, I guess, you know. And
there used to be a time when you would show up with your band and your backup singers and the horn section and the string section, everybody.
Yeah. Well, there's still
now,
some of that going on, for
just
sure.
They sit at home and record it into the computer and send you a little MP3 file via email and say, dub in your voice.
Yeah, it's fantastic. And it's really sparked a lot of creativity, thank goodness. And that's also why the Yes on 19 campaign seems to be taking off among many different types of people. The Los Angeles area, their ears are open. I mean, when all those silly pot clubs popped up everywhere, and then they had to, like, you know, beat them down with a bunch of ordinances and everything, what happened was the neighborhoods were merely annoyed. It was really, I mean, it was not like Sodom and Gomorrah or anything at all. And so they got over the shock, you know, and they did shut 4 out of 5 of the clubs down because they were just everywhere and it was kind of silly and not regulated and everything. All the neighbors knew that it wasn't that bad of a deal. It was a few isolated incidents, but in the hundreds of clubs that opened all over Los Angeles, they were merely annoying some neighbors here and there. So I think that this has allowed the Los Angelinos to really have some more direct experience with the marijuana culture and not be too tainted or destroyed. And all that is actually is a surfacing of what's really been going on this whole time all over America, but particularly in California. Everybody smokes it. And it's silly to send all that money to the, you know, organized crime or whatever, you know, the cartels, when we might as well be honest and grown up about it and get over it, you know? So that's
my mind is that it's taken this darn long to get people to that point. I mean, because you and I and so many others have known for 20 years or more that our farmers could make a ton of money and our job market could open up and we'd have great products to compete with on the foreign trade markets. And yet our politicians have played as limeys.
Well, the problem with the counterculture and the people who, the creativity and everything that happened in the hippie revolution is they turned on, and dropped out when they should have tuned in, turned on, and voted. And, you know, they let the other guys just, you know, take the system and run. And now I think because of this terrible oppression and the crushing of the counterculture and the jailing of every black, brown, and all, you know, counterculture person that they can possibly jail, that we've got to fight back at the ballot box. Luckily, here in California, convicted felons can vote as long as they're not on parole or in prison. You can actually vote by absentee from California jail. And all the marijuana felons, of which there's lots, can all vote. So we're registering people to vote like crazy because I believe that the people are ready to give marijuana peace a chance, which, as you know, was part of my campaign platform in 2006 for lieutenant governor. But this is really something serious to consider, marijuana peace. We've had enough of the marijuana war, and it hasn't worked. And it's made something that's a simple weed the most valuable thing on earth, and funding 65% of the cartel's income from marijuana when all we got to do is grow some and make it, you know, not such a lucrative deal for all these people. And marijuana peace works. We have it here in Marin County, and in West Hollywood we have marijuana peace, and it works. The police have much more important things to do. So, we're launching the Marijuana Peace Coalition with the Libertarian Party and a bunch of activists down in L.A., and we have secured a wonderful show at the John Lovitz Comedy Club at Universal City, which is mainstream America. It's where the King Kong 3D thing is, right? And we're going to be having it's a music and comedy show, and it's called Get Over It, Vote Yes on 19. And we've got this amazing lineup that I can't even divulge, except for Terry Joyce is the co-founder, and she's a well-known, wonderful Hollywood comedian who won. She did Last Comic Standing and won the first season. Woo! You know, very, very funny.
I love her. She's been on the show. I love her.
Give her a
big hug from you when you see her.
Oh, absolutely. And we've just gotten to know each other, but we've been talking a lot and working on this thing, and we managed to put together a show, and we have the Bluzetta Band for the house band to start off, and then Terry Joyce has a wickedly funny lineup that I can't divulge yet. And some speakers, Richard Lee, the writer of Prop 19, will be there, bless his heart. You know.
Co-writer.
And co-writer, yes, that's true, very, very much so. And
he will correct you on that. He did that to me when he was on the show week for last. So.
Oh yes, we must be exact. That's what Richard likes. And then we're going to have an all-star jam at the end of the show. So
what, you're serving dinner? That's cool.
There's food there, yeah. It's the old B.B. King's. Actually, this is a really nice big club, with, you know, and John Lovitz took it over, who's this wonderful man who's very, very funny and very famous guy, and gave us Wednesday night for a green carpet event.
Oh, rock on.
So we are planning many
Rivers
surprises.
And critique the way you're all dressed, and we'll get Henry Hemp to come down the aisle.
Oh, actually, we have other plans than that. But we have some wonderful people, and it's going to be a big surprise and pretty wild. And we have, I think it's going to, you know, elevate the profile of the SN19. And this is a serious change that we need to step all together and step one step forward all together. It's not that it's a little scary for everybody, but it's time. It's time.
It is.
It's absolutely time. And marijuana, give marijuana peace a chance. That's all we are saying.
Well, you know, and I like to see this happen everywhere, because, like, this way we have buying my stuff under the table and, you know, and dark alleys. Because, look, I can't tell you the number of times I've really wanted to get a lawyer and pull the guy who sold me that bag into small claims court and say, look, this is Seeds and Stems, Your Honor. And he said it was a full ounce.
Well, regulation will fix all these problems, you know, and it's going to be sort of a pain, and it's not going to be the Wild West anymore. But they arrested 78,000 Californians last year for marijuana, 61,000 for misdemeanor possession alone. 61,000 misdemeanor possession, that's less than an ounce, arrested in California last year.
Let me say this. If the police department out there is arresting that many people, that means they don't have time to go home and be with their very special significant other, you know, in between the sheets in a, you know.
I have something very sad to report for you.
And I would encourage the entire police department out in California to go home and get with their
friends. Instead. Well, this is a very important thing that listeners need to know, because this is a solid fact from the FBI. In 2008, 61,000 Californians were arrested for misdemeanor possession of marijuana. Okay, not, that's very same year, in 2008, 60,000 violent crimes went uninvestigated due to the lack of police hours in California.
Wow.
That is a solid fact from the FBI. Now, this
Well, they
shows,
can't get their priorities straight in that state, can they?
Right. So every time they arrest a marijuana user, a violent crime is committed and gets away. They get away with it.
And, you know, I'm watching on TV about all these... I'm watching on TV about all these rape cases that are sitting dormant because rape kits aren't being tested. And I'm watching about all these women who need justice and they can't get justice. And I know there's a lot of people out there who've been beaten in the head over some money. And you're right. Our officers are coming in there and arresting people for a plant. Get real.
Yeah, or less than an ounce of pot. Yeah. And so, yeah, this is a terrible waste of time and our tax dollars, and the jail space is... There's a couple of thousand of nonviolent marijuana had people who had more than an ounce, making it a felony, that are in jail tonight in California. Now, the average cost of each and every prisoner in California is $100 a day that the taxpayers get charged by the prison industrial system. So
wow.
Let's do the math here. 2,000 2,000 prisoners, nonviolent marijuana offenders had more than an ounce. Times $100 a day. So, what could we be doing with that kind of money every single day?
We could be buying some really good pot and going on a cruise with that kind of money.
I would open up every closed library in California first so we could re-educate the people for free.
Easy.
You know? So, $200,000 a day into every library in California. All right, let's do that. Oh, that would bring up the education level of every single person, rich or poor, in California. Damn, we have less crime. So, you know, there's a lot of things you could do with all that, and that's just the savings.
Right, and if you weren't putting that many people in those prisons, you wouldn't need to build that many prisons, and maybe you can start building, something as silly like a school or a university.
Right, right. They built 21 prisons in 20 years in California, and they actually got one half of a university built in Fresno that's still pending.
One half of a university.
One half. So that's not very good for last 25 years now, is it?
Well, now, wait a minute. We got Oaksterdam in there. We got that one built.
Yes. Yes, we did. And that is a private school. You know?
Oh, that's right.
That's right. But it's a very good school, and I'm very proud to be friends of Oaksterdam and associated with it.
That's why only in California can you find a school for your privates. That
No. That's not what I said.
Oh, I get it. Oh, privately funded. Now I get it.
God. But it's brilliant. It's conservative. It makes sense. This Prop 19, it makes a lot of sense. And also, it gives a chance for it to develop. It allows the legislature to increase privileges if we're all grown ups and can handle it, and it's okay. You can increase privileges, but it's strictly forbidden from decreasing privileges. And it also preserves all the medical rights of every medical marijuana person. They do not take away any rights. They do not infringe upon medical rights. And the best thing I think that will happen is that the price will be lower for the patients.
Well, see, you just put up this big stumbling block. You said if we're all grown-ups. And according to my mom, all men are kids and we never grow up. So now what are we going to do now?
Well, I think that pot helps people at least mellow out. So if you're not going to be grown-up, at least you can be mellow.
All right. Well, yeah, I am. I have to admit that when I smoke my medication, well, I love it, too. The kids don't say we get high anymore. They say we're going to go out and medicate. Oh,
well, if they're underage, they better have their medical card, you know, and that's the whole deal with Prop 21 is it makes it the same darn thing as alcohol. However, if you have a medical need and you're under 21, get your doctor's note, and you can have your medical privileges. It does not touch any of the medical privileges that we have won so strongly in the courts because of 215 and SB 420. Doesn't touch the right to collectively grow. Doesn't touch our rights to have safe and affordable access. And it doesn't touch our right to have a caregiver if you're too unwell to take care of yourself or grow it yourself or even get to the darn store and get some. You know, I think that adult cannabis use can be regulated because we've regulated medical cannabis use very well. I've got 13 years regulated with no incidents and no violations of all 84 rules. We played by all 84 rules.
Somebody at Facebook wrote a very good question, and we're getting ready to take a commercial break. So let's just chew on this while we're getting high and listening to commercials and jamming up to marijuana music. It says, they say that 21 years is a good age to have cannabis for our use. What they failed to say is that our youth can buy cigarettes at the age of 18. Are they saying that cigarettes are more safe than cannabis? Now, look, I'm just asking the question. That's all. And that's a very good question. So, Lynnett, why don't you pack a great big bowl of some Ed Rosenthal Kush, and I'll fire up these seeds and stems that this cloud tried to pawn off as pot. And when we come back with Ed Rosenthal, we'll talk about that here at Time for Hemp.
THCF Medical Clinics are the premier physicians clinic in the United States. THCF has offices all across the United States from Hawaii to Michigan. THCF Medical Clinics has helped approximately 150,000 patients obtain their medical marijuana permits to legally possess, grow, and use medical marijuana. If you have chronic pain, multiple sclerosis, or any other neurological degenerative disease, or if you have any gastric gastrointestinal disorders such as GERD, irritable bowel syndrome, or if you have AIDS, cancer, spastic disorders, seizure disorders, or glaucoma, call us at 1-800-723-0188 or visit us online at hemp.org. Again, the number is 1-800-723-0188 and the site is hemp.org.
I don't know about you, but when I cultivate my clones, I want to give each and every one the best chance to grow into a mature, healthy plant. But after a few cloning cycles, I experienced decreased root density, slimy stems, or even worse, no roots at all. Growers know that reusing cloning collars results in failed clones. And cleaning cloning collars between grow cycles requires extra work and decreases root density. That's why I use PermaClone. PermaClone collars have been engineered to prevent failed clones by providing heat-sterilizable collars which fit Easy Clone, Turbo Clone, or Power Cloner systems. PermaClone collars can be dry heat sterilized, pressure cooked, or autoclaved to completely kill all bacteria and fungi without harsh chemicals. Start cloning with confidence today and visit us at permaclone.com. Put in the code T for Hemp with your order and receive a 10% discount on your purchase.
Indigrow is your source for affordable induction grow lighting. First discovered in 1891 by Nikola Tesla, Indigrow lights deliver 11 years of electronic sunlight to your plants. Indigrow lamps require less than half the power of traditional HID lamps. Converting to Indigrow lights means you'll cut down on your power bill with less lighting. Indigrow lamps also use 5 times less mercury than traditional fluorescent or HID lamps, making Indigrow not only energy efficient, but environmentally friendly as well. No more switching out lamps between vegetative and flowering stages. As nature intended, your lights get a steady dose of UV light. That makes your plants grow healthier and stronger. Indigrow products are manufactured in San Diego, California, and come with a written 10-year warranty. What Tesla knew, then growers know now, is that Indigrow lighting is the cost-effective addition to your victory garden. To learn more or order now, go to inda-grow.com. That's inda-grow.com. Or call 877-452-2244 to answer any of your questions. These guys really know lights. Indigrow really is your sunlight in a box.
Have you ever had a problem with overcooking your cannabis oil? You probably wanted to rip your hair out when you burned off all the THC, right? I even cried one time when my brownies failed to make a good impression at the party. Well, I stopped crying when I found Magical Butter. Magical Butter is a device with a microprocessor control program sequencer. It was designed by a scientist and a chemist to precisely extract the benefits of various herbs. Magical Butter easily makes botanical butter, oils, tinctures, lotions, sauces, and more. Magical Butter heats your oil and your herbs at the perfect temperature every time. Check us out at magicalbutter.com because it's magical. Okay, there's a lot of science and chemistry involved, but it sure works like magic.
Education and information. See what all the buzz is all about. It's time for Hemp. It's time for Hemp.
Since 1990, over 9 million people have broken the rules and got arrested for pot. That's more than the population combined from Alaska, Montana, Wyoming, and even Vermont. Man, that sure seems like a lot. 2005, over 750,000 American citizens got busted with weed. What burns holes in my tent is 86% were arrested for possession. But what I can't believe is one of those people was me. So what can we do about legalization? But rally around and reform legislation. To state our position and make it our mission. Let's
change in the law is what we need. It's time we legalize weed. Chief Greenbud is spouting about prison overcrowding, using words like reform, rally, and change. Why should we do time for a victimless crime? Marijuana isn't evil, but it's taking the blame. Don't you think that it's time for a change? So what can we do about legalization? But rally around and reform legislation. State our position and make it our mission. A change in the law is what we need. It's time we legalize weed. Let's make it our mission. State our position. Change in the law is what we need. It's time we legalize weed. Yeah, it's time we legalize weed.
Yeah, baby, you've been listening to Chief Greenbud. I love Chief Greenbud. I got to watch him perform live up at the Toronto Hemp Fest in July. He's an amazing entertainer. Very funny man, very bright individual. If you get a chance to see him perform in concert, you should, and I would encourage you to get one of his CDs. Also, I would encourage you to go to NORML.org and find out what you can do to make a difference. If you are not being part of the solution, then there's nothing else to say, but you are obviously part of the problem. Sorry, facts are facts. People who are on the program tonight who are part of the solution, Lynnett Shaw, we've been having a wonderful conversation. I love you. You're just like a little sister to me. You know that.
Oh.
And joining us is my mentor in life, one of my mentors, who I'm very proud to say is a member of my family, Ed Rosenthal. Ed, thank you for joining us.
Hi.
Hi, Ed.
Hi.
Hey, Ed, before we went to commercial, I laid on Lynette's doorstep this question that I found on Facebook today. There's a lot of people who are talking about Prop 19, and this person I have a lot of respect for, and we've learned to have a fun banter about Prop 19. But the question is, let me put it to you like this. They say that 21 years of age is a good age to have cannabis for our use. What they fail to say is that our youth can now buy cigarettes at the age of 18. Are they saying that cigarettes are more safe than cannabis? Just asking.
No.
And that really is a good question, because in Prop 19, it does put the age restriction there. So I'll shut up. I threw it on the table. And I'm not in the fray. I don't have right now really a big horse in this race. So I'll let you and Lynette take it.
Well, the reason why it was put into the proposition is this, that this proposition was put together very scientifically, and they used a lot of focus groups to do it, so that because they didn't want to just have a good try or a moral victory, they wanted a win. So as obnoxious as some of those things in it are, they picked up a few points here and a few points there from them. From putting those things in, and that was the margin that was might be the margin of victory. So I'd rather have those provisions in it than not have an initiative at all, or a winning initiative. And the other part of this initiative says that the legislature can modify this downward. So in other words, they can't make the laws more harsh, but they can make them less harsh. So even though that's put in initially, I think that it will be changed.
And when I've been out there talking to the people, especially around Los Angeles, I've been speaking with a lot of different type of people, they consider adult use of marijuana and intoxicant use, not medical use, just like alcohol. While tobacco is not considered an intoxicant, even though it's deadly and terrible and all that stuff, you know. So this made sense to them, and that's also how we've been winning votes, by making sense about it all.
Okay, cool. Well, like I said, it was a very, when I came across it, it made sense to me. I got thinking, well, yeah, you know, they can buy cigarettes at 18, why not cannabis? So, but now it sounds to me that you, it sounds like people would be more apt to vote yes if you set the age limit on 21, like liquor, correct?
Right. Exactly.
Yeah, this is good for starts. It's a step that we can all agree upon, and that's what we need to do. We need to make that first step, you know, just to try to see what this social experiment will be like. And because the other model has obviously failed and has created a terrible war, you know, that's transcontinental and transcultural, and it's, you know, creating murders over marijuana and the borders and everything. It's just so wrong. I think it's beautifully written. There's some things. There's nothing. No one likes everything about it, you know. But it's really got a chance, and it's really a workable start. Why not?
And, you know, the thing about this is that on the one hand, this is a local initiative, and that is that it only affects the state of California directly. But on the other hand, it affects the whole world. And it's an international initiative. Because once this passes, you know it's going to affect policy around the world. So that's what makes this so important.
Well, now that's what's so weird, because you're right when you said, you know, I can honestly tell you, even though I'm sitting here in Funky Monkey, Indiana, the truth is I've spoken to people in Canada and in England and in Australia and in Germany as guests and so on, and they've all said the very same thing. They and their governments are actually truly watching what California does. And I've had people tell me in Canada that if California passes this, that the very next day their parliament's going to be jumping on putting together a piece of legislation just like it to help bring the end of the war on drugs in their country. Same with the people in Argentina. Same with the people in Australia. I've just been told this from a handful of people from overseas. So really the whole world is watching.
This is going to end the cartels in Mexico, because the governments claim that they make most of their money from marijuana. And this is going to end the cartels' control of marijuana in Mexico. I'm not saying that Mexico isn't going to produce marijuana for the United States, but it will be imported through legal rather than illegal channels. And the cartels, I'm not saying they'll wither away totally, but they certainly won't be involved, just as the mafia got out of alcohol for the most part once prohibition ended. The cartels won't be able to get the money that they were getting once it's legal.
And that's exactly what happened when they legalized alcohol. You know, the taxes came in. There's regulation. They kept it away from the kids, and they got rid of the violent criminals.
Okay, and now, again, some people are also thinking that, and the amount of space that's being provided in this to grow personal medical marijuana, was it 25 by 25? They won't be able to grow all that much. But quite honestly, you can grow a lot in that small space.
Well, the first thing is that I wanted to correct you there. The medical laws and the medical regulations won't be changed at all. So patients will be able to grow as much as they need and take as much space as they need to grow. And that was by a California Supreme Court decision. And so that won't be affected. But what will be affected is going from a felony to grow, which is where it is right now, to totally legal to grow 25 square feet. And 25 square feet, you figure that you can grow, you know, you can put in about 1,500 watts there so that you can grow anywhere between 1/4 to 1/2 gram per watt.
Okay. Then I've got to ask this question, too, because it's been put on the table, because people know that I do talk to a lot of people out there who deal with Prop 19. And the question is, what would the federal government do if medical dispensaries start selling to recreational users? Supposedly today, Attorney Chris Glue said that Prop 19 will supersede 215. So what's up with that?
That's not true. He hasn't read the law. He hasn't read the proposition, and he's just trying to make trouble for it. But it just isn't true.
Yeah, it's simply not true at all.
Not true.
Okay, so will they work hand in hand with each other then, both props?
That's right. The one does not nullify the other, because one is about medical use and the other is about recreational use. So they're about different topics. So,
now, also, people say that your lieutenant governor out there, I think it is just somebody that really needs to be defeated. Because is that right? Because
of their stance on this?
Attorney General. Okay. Can you detail that a little bit more?
It's the attorney. It's the district attorney of Los Angeles, who is he's a nut. He's totally rabid on marijuana, and he's a person who started the closure of the marijuana dispensaries in Los Angeles, which I don't believe will hold for very long. But he has said that he has vowed to be an enemy of marijuana on any level, medical or whatever. And, you know, that's going to help to defeat him. Because I'm not saying that Kamala Harris is great on this issue, but she's certainly not the rabid person that Cooley is.
Cooley has been reported in the Los Angeles papers promising to send the state troopers to shut down every medical marijuana dispensary in the state when elected.
State troopers do not have the ability to do that. By law, you see, the city is regulated. So if he did that, the state would actually be sued. And you have to understand that this is all going on in a state that has had to, in the past year, has had to pay its employees in IOUs because they can't make a budget. It's a state in which they've had to lay off, where Oakland has had to lay off cops. You know, this state is falling apart because it doesn't have tax revenue. And all this guy can think about is wasting taxpayers' money going after a few kids smoking a joint.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
Well, we're getting ready to take a little break here, but Ed, before we do, I want to give a big shout out about that fabulous book you've got. That's a learning tool for Oakland University. Tell people how to get a copy of that.
Well, first of all, people can go onto Amazon and get it. They can go to their local bookstore and ask for it if they don't have it. And many of the chain stores and independents have it. And they can go on the internet on my site to get it, or they could go to FS Books. There are many, many places they can get it. And they can usually pick it up somewhere near them.
Well, here's what I got to get. I got to get the bills paid, and then when we come back, we're going to talk a little bit more about Prop 19. So everybody fire up and tell your friends that it really is time for hemp.
Had a problem with overcooking your cannabis oil? You probably wanted to rip your hair out when you burned off all the THC, right? I even cried one time when my brownies failed to make a good impression at the party. Well, I stopped crying when I found Magical Butter. Magical Butter is a device with a microprocessor control program sequencer. It was designed by a scientist and a chemist to precisely extract the benefits of various herbs. Magical Butter easily makes botanical butter, oils, tinctures, lotions, sauces, and more. Magical Butter heats your oil and your herbs at the perfect temperature every time. Check us out at magicalbutter.com, because it's magical. Okay, there's a lot of science and chemistry involved, but it sure works like magic.
If you are in the Portland, Oregon area and are an OMMP cardholder, then come down to Nikki's Diggity Dank Market. Portland, Oregon's first and only weekly OMMP market, presented by the Alternative Wellness Center, located at 5241 Southeast 72nd Avenue, two blocks south of Foster Boulevard, close to public transportation, held every Sunday 10 a.m. till 7 p.m., connecting quality vendors with patients. Nikki's Diggity Dank Market also has a weekly raffle with products from every vendor. So come down to Nikki's Diggity Dank Market and have fun while connecting with quality vendors and getting great natural medicine. If you are a vendor and want a chance to connect with OMMP patients, you can check out their Facebook page at facebook.com/alternativewellnesscenter or call 971-888-4392. Be sure to register early because space is limited. Nikki's Diggity Dank Market.
I don't know about you, but when I cultivate my clones, I want to give each and every one the best chance to grow into a mature, healthy plant. But after a few cloning cycles, I experience decreased root density, slimy stems, or even worse, no roots at all. Growers know that reusing cloning collars results in failed clones. And cleaning cloning collars between grow cycles requires extra work and decreases root density. That's why I use PermaClone. PermaClone collars have been engineered to prevent failed clones by providing heat-sterilizable collars which fit Easy Clone, Turbo Clone, or Power Cloner systems. PermaClone collars can be dry heat sterilized, pressure cooked, or autoclaved to completely kill all bacteria and fungi without harsh chemicals. Start cloning with confidence today and visit us at permaclone.com. Put in the code T for Hemp with your order and receive a 10% discount on your purchase.
Headshot Canada. Based in Saskatchewan, Canada, it is shaking up the medical cannabis industry. Headshot Canada helps Canadian citizens in getting a medical marijuana license. They do this by filling out the paperwork. They also help explain your needs to your doctor and also help find the right strain for your condition. For this service, Headshot Canada charges a nominal fee of $100 and your participation in a research and development study to test the effectiveness of different cannabis strains on various medical conditions. Owner and founding farmer Tim Selinsky wants every Canadian to know that you have the universal right to a marijuana license. Unlike Compassion Clubs, Headshot Canada's goal is to get the right strain of cannabis for the ailment at a fair flat rate price for the patient, no matter the strain. Headshot Canada offers 57 strains of cannabis grown at family-owned farms in Saskatchewan, as opposed to Canadian federal government's one strain of irradiated garbage grown in a lab. Go to headshotcanada.com.
Free? Did you say free? Free hemp? Free hemp? Free hemp video and audio? Free downloads of all the top artists, all the pot artists on planet Earth. Interviews with all the people making the movement, making the hemp movement. It's time for hemp. That's right, world. It's time for hemp. That's right, world. It's time for hemp.
I'm kinda high. Let me excuse myself. But it seems like it's just moments since we met. I'm kinda high. Let me introduce myself.
Yeah, baby, let me introduce myself. My name, casper-leitch, program high. Time for Hemp. Live all around the world on AmericanFreedomRadio.com and on AM/FM stations all across America. I want to give a big shout out to KDK Distributors. We love you. Thank you for keeping us strong. And Ed Rosenthal, who's on the line, and Lynnett Shaw, who's on the line. And I also want to give a big shout out to all of our friends who listen in at Homeland Security, the Office of the DEA, FBI, and CIA. You people are being paid to listen to this show, so pay attention, stay awake, drink your coffee, and take a lot of notes. Now, Ed, there was Also, another question on Facebook that seemed pretty astute, because I'm baffled with recreational and medical use. And Lynnett, you know, you've been very busy in the medical marijuana too. Feel free to chime in on this. But the question is, if Richard Lee or Oaksterdam or some of these dispensaries have warehouses and sell to recreational users, are they violating President Obama's memo on preempt?
I don't know, but I would like to say that Richard Lee, you know, is a very philanthropic person, and his attitude is the more the merrier. And I think I agree with that, and think that if there are a lot of dispensaries, there's no head cut off. They can just cut off a tentacle. And so it becomes a failure. However, if there are just a few dispensaries or a few manufacturers, then it becomes much easier for the government to try to stamp it out. You know, I'm not. I just want to say, you know, we have a lot of people who did not plan to be martyrs, but are in prison for long periods of time because the government has singled them out.
Yes.
But when you look at the total number of people who are doing this, the government really—it's really been insignificant in terms of affecting the supply. And what they've tried to do is put scare into people, and people aren't really scared anymore, even if they are facing very harsh penalties. So.
In Oakland too, as I know that Richard Lee had worked with a lot of activists in the city government, and they passed several ordinances about having adult responsible use being the lowest possible priority. So there's a lot of layers of ordinances and votes and laws and everything, and making that a unique area.
Yes, and he's a big local booster as well, and. So he termed the phrase Oaksterdam.
Yeah.
And he's been very, very active as a civic booster. So he's a real asset to the city of Oakland.
Worked very hard. And marijuana peace works. You know?
I can't wait to see this happen in a lot of ways, because when I started working in Jack Hare's office back in 91 and began meeting the people in the marijuana movement, you guys know the marijuana movement is my family, and it really grieves me to see my brothers and sisters, one, be shoved behind bars because they touched this plant, and two, be called a criminal because they need this for medication.
Worst thing.
Yeah, I think a lot of the people who are opposed to it are so used to have been sort of outlaws, you know, and seen themselves as outlaws for so long that they're really afraid to join the civil society.
Right.
And that's a part of it. Like, they see themselves as outsiders to the society and not having the same responsibilities as other people.
Hmm.
And as long as marijuana is illegal, that's sort of true, because you say, well, why should I pay taxes if they want to put me in jail? But if they don't want to put you in jail and it's civilly regulated, then you're expected to pay taxes. And a lot of the people who oppose this, basically, whether it's for monetary reasons or for psychological reasons, feel that they won't be outlaws if, you know.
And all those same people are not registered to vote, so it doesn't matter how much they whine.
Right.
If they're not going to vote about it, then, you know, then you just got to not listen to them and do the right thing for everybody else, I guess. You know.
The other thing is that there are a very small proportion of the people who are affected by this.
Oh, yeah.
And the reason why they get a disproportionate voice is because of the thing about being fair and balanced. And I think being fair and balanced for some of these people would be a psychological examination to see what their motives are, to see whether they're crazy, insane, or greedy, or just stupid. Because it's one of those four. And you know, there are some companies here in California who have opposed this and have been trying to buy that's just like one person said that, you know, he spoke to God, and, you know, God said no, you know, but the people will rot, I guess, because he came out opposed to it. I don't know, you know, but I think about it, you know, Jesus was in long hair, he didn't hold the job, he hung out with disreputable people, and he was hated by the establishment. So I think he'd be a good candidate for being picked up as a possible head and smoker, you know. They'd crucify him for that, you know.
Well, that's the end of the show music, so that means it's time for us to go. I love you both. I want to thank you for being part of the show tonight.
Everybody vote yes on 19.
Yeah, and tomorrow night is Leap Night, Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. Every Wednesday night we put a spotlight on all of that hardworking organization. So tell your friends to tune in, and that it really is time for him.
Yes, it's time for him. Whoa, an acre of him makes 20 bales of oil. No need for pesticides. The poison.
And smoke me when I die. And if anyone don't like it, just look them in the eye. I didn't come here and I ain't leaving, so don't sit around and cry. Just roll me up and smoke me when I die. Now you won't see no sad and teary eye when I get my wings and it's my time to fly.
Call my friends and tell them there's a party, come on by. Now just roll me up and smoke me when I die. Roll me up and smoke me when I die. And if anyone don't like it, just look them in the eye. I didn't come here and I ain't leaving, so don't sit around and cry. Just roll me up and smoke me when I die.
Been here long enough. So sing and tell more jokes and dance and stuff. Just keep the music playing, that'll be a good goodbye. So roll me up and smoke me when I die.
Roll me up and smoke me when I die. And if anyone don't like it, just look on me in the eye. I didn't come here and I ain't leaving, so don't sit around and cry. Just roll me up and smoke me when I die.
Take me out and build a roaring fire. Roll me in the flames for about an hour. Then take me out and twist me up and point me toward the sky. Roll me up and smoke me when I die.
Roll me up and smoke me when I die. And if anyone don't like it, just look them in the eye. I didn't come here and I ain't leaving, so don't sit around and cry. Just roll me up and smoke me when I die. Just roll me up and smoke me when I die.